Councillor.
Thank you very much, Karen. So good evening, everyone. Welcome to this sitting of the Erskine and Shinnan, Bishopton and Langbank Co-Partnership meeting this evening. Can I just ask, before we begin, that obviously this meeting's been recorded for members of the public to see what we're talking about. When you are looking to speak on any items, if you use the raise hand feature or if you've got your camera on, can you please just indicate to me if I've not noticed? And obviously, if I've not taken you in before the end of the item, if you want to just sort of butt in, I think is a polite way of putting it, just let me know. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, so any apologies? I do have one from Ali Whitty. He'd contacted me quite late on. So he's offering his apologies. Any other apologies to be offered today?
Yes, Maggie Morrison from Inchinnan Community Council has also submitted her apologies.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so moving on to the business. First of all, sorry, any declarations of interest or transparency statements in relation to today's business? Okay, none intimated. So moving on to item one is the minute of the previous meeting on the 26th of September. Any comments or questions? None indicated. We agree this item. Agreed. Okay, item two is the Erskine and Shinnan Bishopton and Langbank Local Partnership update paper. Thank you for the effort and work that's been put into this paper. I know that it's taken a bit of time for it to come through. Has anyone got any comments or questions? I'll just bring in Annabelle at this point. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to just draw to the local partnership's attention. The draft wording for the priorities is attached within that paper. So really keen to have any feedback to that. The other thing that I just wanted to draw to attention that's not in the paper is I provided a bit of a summary around Winter Connections papers, Winter Connections projects, and there has since been an award to Langbank for a series of family activities in Langbank. So I thought the local partnership would like to see that there was something going on in Langbank as well. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention. Obviously, Jacqueline, you will know about that, but it was agreed after the papers had been submitted.
Okay, no, that's fine. I'm quite happy for that to just be added in part with the minutes for today. Annabelle, thank you very much for that update. That is most welcome. I've seen that Councillor Lee Nicholson had the big thumbs up on that as well. So well done to those that are involved in it. That's excellent news and progress for the community there. So well done to all involved. Any other comments or questions in relation to the papers? I think they're very good. I think that the expansion of the work and the discussion we had previously is very well recognised. So I'm not seeing any hands raised, Annabelle, that's an indication of a good job done. So we agree, item two? Agreed. Okay, item three is applications for local partnership funding for the Erskine and Shinnan Bishopton Langbank local partnership area. So I'm just, if you excuse me, I'm just going to squiz through the papers to find the appropriate page. And item three, if you go through to appendix one, you will see that there are two applications in for consideration. There is one from Inchinnan Community Council regarding the Christmas lights installation, and there is also one from an organisation that we've not had any application from before, which is the Inchinnan Tuesday Club. We do have funds available. I know that when we do the funding at the beginning of the year, that we do have concerns that maybe applications that might come slightly later on. So these are two applications where I feel that they meet the appropriate remit. We do have the funds there. We're also getting towards the end of year. So my recommendation would be for us to award them. That's how I would do it in any meeting. So I'll just open it up to them for any discussion points, and I'll bring in Councillor McLaren at this point.
Thank you, Michelle. I just want to ask about the Inchinnan Christmas lights and the installation. It's just two separate applications, isn't it?
Yes, it's two separate. It's two separate organisations. They're not conjoined. It's just the way they're written on the paper. So I'm happy for you to want to speak to the Inchinnan Community Council one.
Hang on, are they not both? Are they not both for the Inchinnan Community Council?
No, one of them's Inchinnan Tuesday Club.
Is David Woodrow in the meeting? Can I ask?
He's not.
Ike is trying to get in. Just a moment. He's just trying to call me. Oh, David, are you trying to get on the meeting? You can't get the link. There was an email sent out last minute, I think.
Councillor McLaren, I'll send David Woodrow the link again just now, OK?
Right, you're going to get the link sent to you right now, OK? Right out. Thanks, Michelle. I'm asking about the Christmas lighting installation. Is this to go on streetlights, can I ask? What kind of street lighting are we talking about, or are the Christmas lighting?
So in Shannon Community Council, because it is a community council meeting that I attend, they have been looking at this project for the best part of 10 years of trying to get this organised. I'm sure Ian will be able to come in and fill in the gaps far better than I can, because it supersedes my time as a councillor. This is for the village to have its identity and for the lighting programme in keeping with other areas. So it is sort of an appropriate application. I'll see. Councillor Nicholson, do you have anything you want to add at this point? Because you've also been in the meetings with myself as well.
No, I think James's inquiry, I mean, what Shannon Community Councils understand is exactly the same as Bridger Weir and other villages who've applied for Christmas lights to be installed as well. It's a matter for them and the roads department where these lights are installed, where they think they could be installed, etc. So I think, just in simple terms, they're only asking for what other villages have applied for over the years, for some financial resources to help them install Christmas lights around. I think it's mainly around the woodland front, at the front of the village, the small woodland area, and then up around where the Christmas tree is normally located over the festive period as well. That's as far as I know, Chair.
Okay, Michelle, thank you very much.
I can come back in that case. I'm all for Christmas lights. I'm not in any way poo-pooing the idea of Christmas lights, but my understanding is from both Bishopton and Lang Bank is that there's no capacity to install more Christmas lights. So I don't know how Rhodes are planning to put this in, but Bonnie Bishopton got funding a couple of years ago for more Christmas lights. They got part of it installed, and they've still got funding left, and they're not able. They've been told that they can't get any more Christmas lights on the street lamps, so they're having to think outside the box as to how to spend this money on Christmas lighting. So I see Jared Hannah's got his virtual hand up, so maybe he can answer that question.
I've got other speakers first, and then I will bring Jerry in to address off the matter. So what I'll do is I'll bring in Jacqueline Dockery at this point. Thank you.
And I know it was just to say that we certainly got a letter, because Lime Bank did put in a funding application this year, and it was for Christmas lights, but we had to then demonstrate that they would be approved by Renfrewshire, and Renfrewshire Council actually came back and said, no, they will not facilitate. They really shouldn't have been allowing them to be in the villages anyway. They're beyond capacity. They couldn't support it. We've actually gone, the Christmas lights, we're now putting them on the village mugger, which isn't Renfrewshire Council lighting. So we went ahead with the Christmas lights, but it's a village. They're having to install them, and they're having to pay for the ongoing cost, because the Renfrewshire Council have just said they're at capacity for Christmas lights. So, I mean, I'm all for us actually as a local area partnership pushing Renfrewshire Council and saying, wait a minute, do you know, if they actually took even half a dozen lights for the big towns and put them into the wee villages that didn't have, because we've got some like 10 lights that almost stretch along the front, and that's, again, that was funding that we put in, but certainly that was the feedback that we got, that Renfrewshire Council couldn't install or maintain any further Christmas lights within Renfrewshire, that they were at capacity.
Okay, thank you very much, Jacqueline. I'm going to bring in Jerry Hannah at this point, okay?
Thanks, convener. just to touch on a couple of points that raised by Councillor McLaren, maybe Jacqueline, if that's all right. In terms of the community council, so they've been working with, Maggie's been very vocal with John Wallace and my team around this particular issue and the kind of support and advice and guidance that John's been giving Maggie around the installation of the Christmas lights. My understanding is that the £5,000 that the Community Council is bidding for is for the purchase and install. So when the Jacqueline, to pick up on your point in terms of capacity, we have a contract in place with a Christmas festive lighting installer. That contract is at capacity. That's the capacity issue. So there's no impact on this by the Community Council going and getting their own suitably qualified contractor to install. We'll work with the Community Council and make sure it's done in a safe manner, etc., etc. So there's not any issues. So from a capacity point of view, there's not really any problem with the Community Council going and arranging their own suitably qualified contractor to do this for them. And we would be happy to continue and give them any advice and guidance. In terms of Councillor McLaren's point about what kind of lighting, normally when you're talking about a figure of that kind of value, you're talking about maybe one or two kind of signature installations and then some additional kind of street lighting. So again, I'm assuming that the Community Council have an idea in their head what that might look like. But then again, we'd be happy to support them and maybe point them in the right direction of suppliers, etc., to get them what it is they're looking for.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Kerry at this point.
Thanks, Convener. I would just like to give you a bit more information because I did actually speak to Maggie about this application and I did the summary for it. So they are looking to, it's kind of a two-part application. So the total of all of the lights and installation was £10,000 and they're looking for £5,000 this year and with the intention of coming for £5,000 next year as well. And they have been, Maggie has said, I think Gerard had actually touched upon it, she has been speaking with the council about that, about the costs. I don't know any information about locations or anything like that, but I just wanted to come in and say that Maggie had said it was with working with the council, so it wasn't over and above, she'd already been having conversations with them. So I don't know if that makes a difference or answers any questions, but I just thought I'd give you that information.
Thanks very much, Kerry. I think it just gives us a bigger picture on it and understanding. Obviously, we can't make comment on anything that might be applied for next year is the only thing I will say. Bring in Councillor McLaren.
Okay, thank you, Michelle. And thank you for the update from Gerry Hanna. If I understand it correctly, an organisation can apply for funding for Christmas lights, providing they find a contractor and pay the contractor to install them. Is that my understanding? Is that correct?
Yep, that's correct, Councillor McLaren. Yeah, thanks, Convener. Yeah, that's correct, Councillor McLaren. I suppose what organisations just need to be aware of is the storage of the festive lights and that the in-between period as well. So they need to have somewhere identified that their investment isn't going to be wasted after a few months of unsuitable storage somewhere. So that's just worth bearing in mind. But Maggie will be well versed in that kind of thing, I would imagine.
Okay.
I was going to say, I think that Gerry, you don't need to worry about that with Maggie. I think that she's well on top of that because that's part of what the discussions have been with this whole time frame. At the Community Council as well, and Maggie's been very centre to that.
So the application presumably includes storage somewhere in that case. Can I ask, there's two reference numbers here, there's FR1161 and FR1163. FR1161 is for £5,000. And FR1163 is for £5,000 applied for. How much are we actually going to give the Inchinnan Community Council?
So the numbers here, there's been a bit of a typo, I think, in the way the numbers have been written here. So there's two different applications here. I'm going to go by the ones that are on the actual application forms rather than the one that's in the table there. So FR1163 is for Inchinnan Community Council, and that is for the Christmas lights installation. That is a separate application of which my recommendation is for us to give the award. We have the money and we're coming up to the end of the financial year, and if we don't use our funding, we're at risk of losing it. And this is an organisation that is showing that they are able to use the money in that time frame. The other organisation that is, the same identity, it's suitable, it's within the remit, they're an organisation that have never came to the local partnership before, is the Shannon Tuesday Club, which is FR. I've got 1163 on this one as well. So I'm going to bring in Kerry just to confirm that they are two different applications and that it's just a typo with the numbers.
Yes, it is two different applications. I think when we've put the number FR1163 on the Inshinnan Community Council, it's actually meant to be FR1161. So it's just okay. A typo.
Thank you. So it's two separate organisations. So that the Inshinnan Tuesday Club are asking for £2,000, and this is in relation to their Christmas offering to support people in the community. So they've never been here before. They can also spend the money in the timeframe that we've got left between now and sort of the changeover. So my recommendation would be for us to award the £2,000 to this organisation and the community as well.
Agreed.
Okay, agreed. Thank you.
Okay.
Right, okay, sorry, I'm just going to go back up to the agenda. Sorry, I'm trying to do paper free and it sometimes does throw me off slightly. Okay, so item 4 is the Renfrewshire Local Development Plan, of which we've got is Alan Wilson. There you are. Hi, Alan. Welcome to the local partnership. You just want to come in. I'll leave you to do your thing.
Yeah. I've got a presentation to do. Sorry, I don't have a copy of the agenda. I actually thought Jamie was on ahead of me, so it's taking me a wee bit unawares, but that's fine.
I'm quite happy for Jamie to go first or yourself.
I'm easy, okay. Unless Jamie is desperate to go, I'm happy to let Jamie go first if he's other things to do, or I can go. So give Jamie that option.
No, I'm happy to stick with the agenda. Okay. You want to go next?
That's fine. I'll okay, do that. Yeah. Okay, a wee presentation which I'll share. Share now, and I'm just going to go into hopefully into slide screen. Slideshow mode, which means I won't be able to see MD. So, councillor, I'll maybe rely on you if MD's got the hand up to give me a shout and let me know. Otherwise, I can take questions at the end. Okay, can folks see the presentation?
Yep.
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, dokes. So my name's Alan Williamson. I'm the Strategy and Police Manager with Renfrewshire Council. And one of the things I'm responsible for is preparing the local development plan. And the local development plan is the document that sets out the council's strategy and policies for the use of land and buildings, not just Renfrewshire Council land and buildings, but all land and buildings. It's also the document we use to help us determine planning applications. So just to provide a wee bit of context, the local development plan together with a Scottish Government document called the National Planning Framework is what forms the kind of statutory development plan for Renfrewshire. I'll talk a bit more about the National Planning Framework in a second. Also going to talk tonight about local place plans, which are community prepared plans, and I'll say a bit more about the opportunity for community to prepare them. Regional spatial strategies are also on that document, that illustration there. I'm not going to mention them tonight, they're for further down the road. So the National Planning Framework is a Scottish Government document, part of the development plan. It was approved in 2023, and it's one of the documents we now use to help us determine planning applications and prepare our own local development plan in Renfrewshire. So looks at things from a kind of national perspective. The three key themes that it has is about the creation of sustainable places, the creation of livable places, and the creation of productive places. And the climate and nature crises are really front and centre in that document. They're kind of that is policy one in the document is about the climate and nature crisis. The Renfrewshire Local Development Plan is the document we prepare as a, oh, excuse me, the document we prepare as a council. there's a plan already in place, adopted in 2021, and some of you might have been involved in that, certainly councillors through approval processes and maybe some of the community members through our community engagement. We've got a new plan now under preparation. We recently published a development plan scheme in relation to that, which sets out how we're going to prepare the plan and when we're going to prepare the plan and how we'll involve communities in that. We've always involved communities in preparing our local development plans, but there is a statutory requirement to do that, but that's really been stepped up under the new Planning Act with a specific requirement to include children and young people in the preparation of the plan. I'll say a bit more about that soon too. And just looking ahead, the likely main issues that we'll be dealing with in the new plan is land for new housing development, where that should go, land for new business development, where that should go, and the associated infrastructure associated with that. We'll have our own take on the climate and nature crises and the impacts of that in Renfrewshire. Local living is about making services as closely available to people in their neighbourhoods as possible. And Greenbelt, development of Greenbelt, protection of the Greenbelt is also always an issue when we're preparing the new plan. As I say, there's a new planning system in place. The plans we're preparing now are going to be different from the ones you've seen in the past. That to be place-based, so there's going to be a greater focus on site briefs and master plans, a real focus on what is to happen in places like our town centres, on strong guidance on what our new housing development should look like. And so less policy wording in the plan, because the National Planning Framework now has that policy wording. And as I've touched on, a focus on the climate emergency and nature crisis. The plans are to be people-centred, so putting people and communities at the heart and meeting people's needs and aspirations, and that's about obviously preparing the plan collaboratively, as we've spoken about, and we've started that process. And the plans have also to be delivery focused. One of the big aspects of that is infrastructure first approach. So making sure that the infrastructure required to support developments is either there already or it's coming forward as part of the development. And that's infrastructure in its widest sense. Maybe that, we might think of roads, but also about open spaces, also about health facilities, etc. The plan preparation process follows a statutory process. There's a first phase of evidence gathering, which we're in just now. We gather all that evidence together into an evidence report, and it gets sent off to the Scottish Government, who undertake a gate check to determine if we have sufficient evidence to go ahead with preparing the plan. And when we're gathering that evidence together, we consult on that, we share the evidence we're using, and we seek comments on that before we send it off our gate check. The next stage is, once we've been through the gate check, we start work on preparing the proposed plan. Again, there's engagement at stage two. There's a formal statutory consultation period at which people can object to the proposals in the plan. And if those objections aren't resolved, again, it goes to the Scottish Government, who examine the plan via reporter, and the reporter makes a determination on those objections and makes recommendations to the council. And only after that can we go ahead and adopt the plan. So there's community engagement throughout the process. As I said, with the evidence gathering stage at the moment, we've been doing some early community engagements. We'll publish a survey to allow people to have their say on Renfrewshire's places and submit ideas for the plan. The Have Your Say survey is still live at the moment, and the link's there. I'll share this presentation later for it to be distributed. We have been engaging with children and young people. So far, we have been into 8 of Renfrewshire's secondary schools. In this area, we were into Park Mains about a month or so ago, and we've been to 7 of the other schools. We have contacted every secondary school to go into it. So these are just the 8 that have come back to us, and we've managed to arrange, and we've been working with youth services on that. So it's been a collaborative process, and we do intend to go into the primary schools too. We're preparing the evidence report just now, and we will consult on the evidence we have gathered early in 2025. So we'll share that with all stakeholders and let them offer their opinions on the evidence we have gathered. And just to give a flavour of what the type of evidence is, so the plan will be supported by a transport appraisal to make sure all the proposals that are in it are accessible and sustainably accessed, and that the road and the sustainable access network can accommodate the increased usage of them. We'll be doing an open space audit. We'll be undertaking a strategic flood risk appraisal. Council's already prepared a housing need and demand assessment. So the evidence is quite wide ranging and covers quite a lot of topics. And as I said, the evidence will then go through a gate check undertaken by an independent reporter. This is our timeline for preparing the plan. We're at the evidence report stage just now, and it's red circled because there's community engagement involved at that stage. And then we do the proposed plan preparation is also circled because, again, there's community engagement at that stage too. Because of all these statutory processes, the plan preparation does take some length of time, and we hope to have the plan adopted in 2027. So the local development plan is the plan that's prepared by the council in collaboration with communities. There is another form of plan that's came through the most recent planning act called local place plans, and these are community prepared plans. So just going to give you a flavour of these. So they are community prepared plans that set out proposals for the development and the use of land. The council's role, we will offer community support in preparing these plans, but ultimately the council's role is to validate the plans and maintain a register of them, but it really is the community that decides the content. Local place plans can be prepared at any time, but those local place plans that are submitted to us by the 31st of October next year, we are required to take them into consideration when we're preparing the local development plan. So just a bit more on the requirements and processes of local place plans. They must be prepared by a community body. So that could be a community council or some other constituted community body. So for instance, a development trust. They must contain proposals about the development or the use of land. And there's other regulations associated with them that must fulfil too. Any community that's preparing one, the council would give some advice on those regulations and other requirements. In terms of what is a proposal to the development or the use of land, just to give you a flavour of what is and what isn't. So infrastructure is about the use of land, renewable energy, active travel, community food growing, housing, employment, tourism, obviously, open space, the natural and built environment, and improvements to town and local centres. Non-development matters would be matters such as litter management, dog fouling, events, or improvements to public transport services themselves. So where your else public transport infrastructure would be the use of land, actual services aren't. But that's not to say, as long as there's some proposals in there about the development use of land, it is possible for local place plans to touch on some of these other issues too. Just some other requirements to give you an idea. So a local place plan must be prepared by a community body, and that community body must be identified in the plan. They must be contain a map showing the boundary of the area covered by the plan, and they must include some narrative to just a statement of the proposals that are in the plan. In terms of support from the council has already has a how-to guide, and it's updating that at the moment. We'll soon make that available on the council website. We can provide mapping to support the preparation of plan. We've already done that with some community groups, provided with some mapping. We can suggest where funding might be sought to seek some support for preparing the plan. And within the council itself, although the Sustainable Communities Fund is paused at the moment, that's a possible source of funding for preparing a local place plan. We can help you in pointing in the direction of data to support you preparing the plan. We can offer a staff to come along to a startup meeting, and we've done that with various communities to go into a bit more detail about what's processed, about the process and how we can assist. And when a plan is by a community under preparation, we're happy to look at drafts of that and coordinate the council response if it affects other relevant council services. And this last slide is just, so, as I say, hopefully this presentation can be shared around. These are just live links to some resources that will help help communities prepare a local place plan if they choose to. So that's the end of my presentation. And yes, the other thing I can do, sorry, my screens are playing up. I know the priorities of the group are for discussion later, but if I can indicate how they kind of link to the planning process, if that would be a helpful thing to do, would that be, can I quickly do that? I do see a hand up. I could take that question just now or wait to the end. I'll be guided by you, Councillor.
Okay, I'll ask Eckerson,
Eirlie
Nicholson, if she wants to wait or if it's relevant to right now.
Okay.
I can wait, if I can come back, no problem.
Okay, dokes. Okay, I'm just going to quickly share screen again. So I know these are draft priorities, or understand these are draft priorities, and we'll have discussion later, but it was just to give you a flavour of how, where the relevance to these are to both the local development plan and the local place plan. So leisure and culture, so it would be a role of the local development plan to identify and protect leisure and cultural facilities, and local place plans could, for instance, set local aspirations for facilities. In terms of connectivity, local development plan can protect access routes and identify proposed new routes to be provided by the council. And again, local place plans can help identify locally important routes and locally aspirational routes too. On health and wellbeing, local development plans will consider local living, including access to health facilities. And obviously there's improved wellbeing through access to green spaces and active travel, and that would also be a consideration. Local place plans can identify issues with and aspirations for health facilities. In terms of intergenerational working, I've talked about the preparation of the plan we've been working with school children on that. So engagement in the local development plan and local place plans could support intergenerational working. For community identifying, local development plans will identify designated natural and historic environment assets. Local place plans could identify more locally important assets that aren't nationally identified. Planning and environment is obviously directly linked to these documents. And in terms of community power plant, local place plans, they are a statutory plan, and the council has to consider them in preparing its new local development plan. So for communities that want to down that route, it is quite an empowering tool. I'll just stop sharing there. A couple other things. Local place plans, they kind of determine their own boundary, so they don't need to follow a community council boundary. They could overlap community councils, or they could just cover part of a community council. The other thing, I've obviously indicated that communities can set out aspirations in their local place plan. They don't, particularly under current financial climate, it doesn't commit the councils to meeting those aspirations, but it certainly kind of puts them into on record that the council, that a community has aspirations for certain things, but it wouldn't necessarily, or it doesn't commit the council or the HSCP, for instance, into having to meet them. That's, everything has to be realistic in terms of budgets. So, yes, that's me, councillor.
Okay, I'll just bring in Councillor Airlie Nicholson. Thank you very much. That was very, very informative, and appreciate how conjoined it was to the connection of that. So, Councillor Airlie Nicholson, followed by Councillor McLaren.
Thanks very much. That was a really helpful overview, Alan, in terms of that. I suppose, first of all, what I would want to say is that I'm really pleased to see that in terms of consultation, it's widened to include children and young people. Scottish Government's got an approach called GIRFEC, and GIRFEC's called Getting It Right for Every Child. And if we're looking at what resources need to go into communities round about planning, we should be looking at that from a child's perspective, about their ability to access services, to access community, activity, education, and not be remote, even if you stay in a village, from the other opportunities that are available to anybody else. And I actually do believe that's been missing in the planning system. We have not looked at what will it be like to live in this community from a child's perspective. What do we want them to have access to, you know, as they're growing up and as they're getting older? What do we want their life to be? And actually, in some of these communities, and we know certainly even from the likes of Dargavel, we've got lots and lots of houses, but we don't have lots and lots of opportunities for people. So I'm hoping that that's the same. I'm thinking about Langbank also, where there's a community of young people who have the same aspirations as every other young person, but have a lack of opportunity in terms of access to other communities, active travel, etc. So I'm kind of hoping that there's something in the local development plan that really addresses that issue, and that's a kind of focal part of making best use of the children's voices and the young people's voices in terms of the consultation that you're doing. And I'm glad to see it's primary, because sometimes we focus on secondary because it's easier to get that kind of information out of them. But actually, I think we need to be thinking preschool as well, and I think actually you can work with children in preschool round about what they would like to see in the future, because you can still that down to actual actions that can come from there as well. So really, that's what I wanted to say. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. I'll just clarify. Firstly, I should say I see Lizzie's on the meeting, so we'll work very closely with Youth Services on this, and it's been a good collaborative approach, and we couldn't have managed. We've been getting into the schools, but it's been with Youth Services staff there, so it's been less daunting having them there to run things. I think we'd have been like rabbits and headlamps if it was just getting in. We haven't been into primary schools yet. We've had to focus on secondary schools so far, but one of the things we have to prepare in relation to the plan is something called a place efficiency assessment to check where play areas are throughout Renfrewshire. So we're going to, when we're doing primary school consultation, it's going to be focused on that. So thank you.
Can I say so just as a wider than play facility, sorry, because sometimes I think we think in terms of planning, we think how many play parks are there. I think the issues are much wider than do we need a play park in the area. Thanks.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, obviously as this develops, I'm quite happy for more information to come back to the local partnership as sort of there's lessons learned or anything that's sort of gleaned information that is perhaps deemed to be sort of appropriate for the local partnership to sort of understand the approach. And then that way, if we've got any further questions, I'm sure that Alan and his team will be quite happy, and Lizzie will be quite happy to address off those points as well. I'm getting nods, so thank you. We're going to bring in Councillor McLaren, followed by Councillor Nicholson.
Thanks, Michelle. And thanks to Alan for the talk there. My question is around housing and how much pressure is on Renfrewshire Council to provide more housing, and because I think that's something that local villagers are probably concerned about a lot is how much pressure there is on the Green Belt, etc. Do we know how much housing we have to provide that the maybe Scottish Government has requested us to provide? Can we provide that by our existing housing, the existing developers, development that has been granted, and brownfield sites, or is there pressure on the greenfield sites, the Green Belt, to release more land for housing? Thank you.
Okay, well, we're at early stage in that process, but yet the National Planning Framework itself sets a kind of minimum housing land requirement for Renfrewshire, and it is, I've got it here in front of me, but it's around, for a 10-year period, it's around a requirement for about 5,000 houses, 4,900. And we need to do that's a minimum over a 10-year period. We need to do a bit of consideration about issues that they've also set out, issues we might want to consider as to whether we should increase that figure. So that work's ongoing at the moment. We obviously do have a land supply at the moment. We need to do a bit of work around that, about how likely what proportion of that will come forward during that 10-year period. And whether we need additional housing land. So we're early in that stage, so I wouldn't want to start any kind of hair running as to the amount of kind of additional housing land we're going to need. In terms of pressure for additional land, we go through the same process as previous plans. The house building industry has an opportunity during the plan process to come to us and suggest where they would like to build, and submit proposals to the plan for that, and we need to assess all of them. And some of that land is obviously greenfield sites, so that'll be we will need to be looking at those sites and assessing them as part of the process, and ultimately the proposed plan would go off to for examination, and builders, if their site wasn't in it, for instance, they can object to their plan, their site not being in the site, so the reporter would ultimately take a view on that. So I think we do expect to have to find some additional housing land. Too early to say too much, too early to say if where we need to be looking for that, but in terms of the pressure for some of that development to be on greenfield land, it will come from the development industry.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Councillor McLaren again, because I think this is a follow-up, then followed by Councillor Nicholson.
You're very, very correct, Michelle. It's a follow-up. I guess how much we have brownfield site in Renfrewshire. So how much can we say to a developer, no, we don't want you to build here. Why don't you build here instead on this brownfield site? Because if we gave the developers what they wanted, we'd have no greenfield sites left in Renfrewshire, I think.
Yeah, I mean, our starting point, for instance, is looking at the vacant and derelict lands within Renfrewshire, not just because it's a brownfield, it's quite often in more sustainable locations because it's within town, so it already has infrastructure attached to it, it's already on, you know, bus and transport routes. So there's always a starting point to look at brownfield land first as the most sustainable option. What the stage we're not at yet at the moment is just of whether there's sufficient brownfield land to meet all the requirements we're going to have. But the first preference is to look towards brownfield land. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay,
I'm going to bring in Councillor Nicholson. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. on the question previously about Girfect, the council did approve a policy a number of years ago that Girfect should be part of our planning assessment processes, so I mean, we fully expect to see that reflected, the principles of it reflected through the new LDP. It's not me putting Alan on the notice or anything like that. I'm just saying it's actually fact that the council did agree that a number of years back. And we've yet to see how that plays out with influencing the local development plan. So it's just for information at that point. My question for Alan was, in one of his slides, he touched on it there, but assessment. It says proposed development site appraisal. And I mean, the question is, who does the appraisals? Because generally speaking, the developer puts forward the site that they quite like, and usually Greenfelt, because they make more profit out of it. And then there's some sort of a appraisal methodology should be applied. Now, I think, I've always thought the local communities should understand what that methodology is, mm-hmm. and what you're holding these sites up against with regards to appraisal, rather than just looking for raw numbers. I'm not being critical, I'm just saying a lot of the years in planning I've been involved in, it's always been very target-focused with delivering the number of housing units required. At times, it's never been that clear about the methodology or the justification for some sites as opposed to others. And that's allowed the applicant to run away to the Scottish Government and get their sites overturned on appeal and all the rest of it. But the communities that are possibly impacted by those sites are none the wiser to how the process actually works. So there's something to my mind where through this new LDP we're doing just now in the NPF4 basis, that the planning system has to be far more transparent about, you know, sites that are put forward, sites that are appraised, and obviously sites that, particularly Greenfield sites, who it should be recognised if a developer or a landowner comes forward with a site, there should also be a counter product to that, not just looking to how do we approve that site or whatever reason it's not back, lack of school capacity, road capacity, sewage, whatever, but also the value of that site that should be part of the process with regards to biodiversity and what it provides to the wider community. So when you're looking at sites and sites appraisals, I just think that sites should be looked at for their value as well, and the loss of that site should be part of the equation, not just it's going to give us 400 houses, yeah, we can accommodate that, yeah, we can get them in schools, yeah, but there's a wider context there with regards to appraising of sites. So my question to Alan is, who actually does the appraisals? Because a lot of the times the developer sticks in their own ideas. Yep. They've done the work, and the planners tend to say, okay, then we accept it all, or maybe not, as the case may be, but they're usually quite rare. So really just how the appraisal methodology works, and how is that going to be transparent for local communities to engage in that process rather than campaign against it, if you know what I mean? Open up the process to the wider community. It might be a shorthand of that. Thanks. That's just a question, I think.
Yep. In terms of that appraisal process, I was talking about the evidence report and consulting on the evidence report. So one of the evidence report templates we'll be preparing will be setting out what that appraisal process will be, the criteria and the factors we'll be looking at. So we will be consulting on how we'll go about the appraisal process as part of the evidence report consultation, and then that will go through the gate check. In terms of doing the appraisal, that sits with us and that sits with the planners and the local development plan team. You are right in so much as a builder who is proposing a site would normally submit quite a lot of detailed information towards that appraisal process and support of their site, and that's one of the things we obviously need to look at. I understand the process, Remsha, in the past as part of that appraisal process, we undertake a community consultation. That's how it's been done in the past. So a kind of almost a draft appraisal has been of a site has been undertaken, then that's published to allow communities to comment on how the site has been assessed. So that's how we undertake the appraisal process. So I suppose added transparency this time round is we will be setting out in advance of the appraisal process how we're going to go about it and seeking comment on that.
Okay,
Is there any other comments at this point? David Woodrow.
Hi, Alan. At the moment, you say that there's a requirement for 4,900 houses for Renfrewshire. Is that as of now, or is that and not counting housing that has already been passed as planned, or is it as of? My example is, we are here at the moment, we've got 2,300 houses built, there's another 2,000 still to be built. Are they, is that 2,000 in the 4,900, or is there more, is there the 4,900 on top of that?
The 4,900, it's called a minute, so it's a minimum. The minimum, this minimal all housing, all 10-year housing land requirement. It's for 10 years, but NPF4 National Plan Framework says it hasn't set out when that 10-year starts. I suppose it's still to be tested, but how we are working is when we publish the plan and the proposed plan, that it should have land for, as a minimum, 4,900 houses in it. So our starting point is when the plan is published.
Okay.
The land supply we have in Renfrewshire at the moment is not all going to have been built out by the time the plan's published. So some of the housing sites that are in Renfrewshire at the moment will be carried forward into the new plan and will contribute towards that that housing land requirement. It's going to be more than 4,900 because that's a minimum, and that's what the Scottish Government are telling us. So I understand there's an authority somewhere in Scotland, I can't remember who's just went one more than what NPF4. So if it was, did a requirement for 10,000, they've gone 10,001 and justified that. But yes, so some of the housing land in Renfrewshire at the moment will contribute towards meeting that 4,900. That answers your question.
Okay.
I'm conscious it's probably getting into quite technical stuff here, mm-hmm. but so happy to talk about that separately, David, at some point to explain that further.
I think we have to look at the elements of sustainable communities that are in that, because this is no longer a sustainable community in this part of the world.
Yeah. Okay, so obviously this is just a starter for six rather than an end point in conversation, yeah, to give assurances, I think is what Alan is trying to say here. So, you know, just know that if there is any, this is a subject matter that is of interest, I think, in general to this local partnership area. It's the only one I can really comment on. You know, planning is something that there is an interest, even if it is slightly technical. So you'll always be welcome if there's something that you want to sort of discuss. So happy to bring back, sort of, even if there's sort of very specific things people want to have a think about, and we want to maybe get an officer down to, or if it's Alan, to maybe come and speak to us about those things, happy for you, for members, to drop me an email and I can get that organised for another meeting at another point in time as well. So in relation to this, I think we've had a decent amount of conversation about this, and I thank Alan for that presentation and for taking those questions. Are we quite happy to move on to the next item? Nods. Yep. Okay. Thank you very much, Alan.
Thanks for having me along. Thank you.
You're done. So if you want to leave the meeting, feel free to do so. Okay. Thank you very much.
I will do. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you. And likewise, for officers that are in, once your items are relevant and done, I'm quite happy to leave as well. So the next item is the Community Justice Renfrewshire presentation. We have previously had some very in-depth conversations about community justice, and as a local partnership area, you know, sort of our role within that. So, Jamie, welcome to the local partnership. You're very welcome to be here this evening, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Chair. Thank you very much for having me along tonight. I've been looking forward to taking you through this presentation, which is quite short, but hopefully will stimulate a wee bit of discussion at the end. So let me sort out my screens first of all. Okay. Has that come up for everyone okay?
Yeah, that's absolutely fine, Jamie.
Is that all right? Good stuff. Let me just move this slightly. There we go.
Okay, so yeah, thanks very much, everyone. For those of you that I haven't met before or been introduced to, I am Jamie Gardine. I am the Community Justice Lead Officer within Renfrewshire Council, and I am based within the Chief Executive Service. In my role, I lead a partnership that's tasked with making progress towards national justice improvement outcomes. Our partnership is composed of quite a wide variety of stakeholders. So we have colleagues from the HSEP, we have colleagues from Police Scotland, Skills Development Scotland, Third Sector through Alan, who's on the call tonight, and other organisations like Victim Support Scotland as well, and Lomos, the Governor from Lomos comes along too. So it's quite broad. What we're tasked with is making the right conditions in Renfrewshire so that people who offend are held to account, and really they stand the best chance of leaving that offending behaviour behind them. We have there is a justice partnership in every authority in Scotland. The structures are slightly different in each place, but we all learn from each other. And locally, we complement the national initiatives. So where there are maybe other policy shifts, or where there are national shifts in practice, for example, social work, we complement that at a local level. I thought the first thing to do would be to actually go into the definition of community justice, because it can be one of these slightly odd concepts that you think you know what it means when you read it superficially, but then when you actually try and respond to it, it can be a bit of a challenge. So the definition that should be consistent across Scotland, the hymn sheet that we're all singing from, is this one. And it's where people who have broken the law are held to account. And that's really, really important, because this is about responsibility, people accepting responsibility and being accountable for their offending behaviour, and then helping them reconnect and contribute to their communities. And that's why some terminology around community justice, for example, community payback order, it's important that people in communities see what has happened and actually see a tangible output for people who are then undertaking community-based work. The next three sentences is really important as well. It's where it's safe to do so. People receive community-based sentences because, as well as addressing need, it's really important that when we're making decisions or when we're influencing decisions, that we really take heed of risk. And that is at the forefront of everything that we do to make sure that we're protecting everyone in our communities. The last point there about the evidence shows that community justice is effective in helping people breaking the law. Fundamentally, that's what it's all about. It's smart justice. It's shown to work. So where people who serve custodial sentences tend to reoffend between 40 or 49% of the time in the case of short-term sentences, is a lot lower. It hovers around 30% for community-based approaches. So it's worthwhile. Let's see. Okay, so the next wee thing I thought would be important would be to acknowledge the news and everything that we're seeing and hearing just now. It's quite hard not to notice justice in the profile that it has. And that's just a snippet of some of the headlines that I found quite easily. The one on the right being just from, was it yesterday or the day before? Now, this is useful in a way because the demands on the prison estate just now is really taking the conversation and focusing it and giving it a sense of urgency. It's something that we all need to be alert to and start problem solving and a response with. In Scotland, we do imprison more people or imprison people more often than any other country in Europe. So the problem in that we're experiencing here is particularly acute. We're also finding that despite recent work to try and avoid using short sentences where we can, we're still using them a lot of the time. Around three quarters of custodial sentences handed out in Scotland are short-term sentences, and these are really quite damaging because for a lot of the time these relate to offences, or they relate to people who we could probably get to the root cause of their offending behaviour better in the community. But what we're doing is we're disrupting their lives, we're disrupting the lives of everyone else round about them. and giving ourselves a lot of work to try and pick that up when they're at the point of reintegrating again. The other problem that we have, and it's in a similar vein, is actually that a lot of people in custody are on remand. So it hovers between around 20 or 25%, certainly in terms of the Renfrewshire population, that's where it is. And the amount of time that people can spend on remand is really quite significant. And again, to the point where it's disruptive. It's not something that people can then return to their lives to quite easily or quite seamlessly. They've probably had to abandon their job, their relationships have suffered, basically life has been on pause. Now, I'm very mindful of what I'm saying here is from the perspective of the person who's committed the offence, and, you know, the thing I'm trying to highlight as well is the community benefit too. But obviously there are people who are impacted by crime, there are victims of crime. And this is really important, and we need to make sure that we're balancing the needs and the kind of data and insight and the concept of smart justice against the expectations of people that have been impacted by crime as well. And that's something that we're really, really sensitive about in our partnership and the messaging that we undertake. Oops. So I wanted to go into a wee bit more about the benefits of community justice. It is what we need in Scotland. The Community Justice Scotland Act in 2016 set out an approach where local justice partnerships can add value to that national work, and really make sure that we are hopefully using or making best use of the community-based justice resources that we have. The important thing to remember is that a lot of the people that we're sending to custody are from deprived backgrounds. We're really reinforcing a cycle of disadvantage. A lot of the time, people in their early life, they've been affected by really negative parental influences. They've maybe not had the best time at school. They've maybe had a lot of adversity. Their health behaviours aren't particularly positive. Their diet's probably pretty bad. You know, there's a lot of evidence in history of substance misuse. Leisure and recreation isn't there. A lot of the time people have experienced emotional and physical trauma, really negative life experiences. The social and physical environment that they are living in through poor quality housing, or by the fact that if they're living in poverty, they can't maybe access the opportunities that everyone else can. If they've not got access to good employment opportunities, or there's a barrier there, it really makes it difficult, and it leads to offending behaviour. And a lot of the time, justice is the final milestone. You know, it's all these challenges that people have had through their life, but then offending behaviours end the result. And I often think of justice as that final safety net that picks people up and stops them from going any further. But then the hard work is trying to unpick everything. You almost need to go back and deal with everything that was there before. There was a really good quote that I heard. Sorry, my son, he's just brought me a cup of tea. He's well trained. Give me any trouble for using the kettle later. Yeah, it was a really good quote I heard, that it's really difficult, or there's not a lot of benefit in punishing a person who's broken. You're not going to get a good outcome. You're going to have much more success if you help repair that person, and that's certainly the approach that we advocate for. I put a couple of images on this slide here. So the one in the far left, employability support, is so, so important, because once people have access to jobs, it then means that they can access more opportunities. They're more likely to have better personal relationships in their life, which takes them further away from the risk factors that lead to offending behaviour. In the community, people can be really well supported with their addiction issues as well. The one with the tag, I think, is really, really powerful, and it's that disruption that it has in the family, because again, it's not just the person who's offended, it's, you know, it could be their sons, their daughters, their wives. There's often a massive void when people go to custody, and because of the stigma, sometimes there can be a delay in people that are remaining, the families that were around that person asking for help. And the last wee image on the right-hand side is actually people can learn a lot of skills when they're in the community. We can actually focus that energy and attention and use it in a productive way. The last wee thing I'll finish on here is one that sticks in my head, and it's actually the financial benefit as well. When somebody's serving a custodial sentence, and an average it costs about £50,000 a year, but a community-based sentence is £5,000, so it's a tenth of the cost. So economically, it makes a lot of sense. So in Renfrewshire, we're doing a lot of good work, and I split it into three parts here because generally that's how I like to think about it. Early measures are where we really try and capture people before they go further into the justice system. And apologies if I use terms here that people aren't familiar with, and we can come back later on, but generally, you know, people are diverted where they can be if their offence is relatively low tariff, where we work with them really intensely for a short period of 3 to 6 months to really help refocus them and say, right, come on, get your act together. What do you need? How can we help? And we have a really, really strong service in Renfrewshire around diversion. We receive the highest number, or we commence the highest number of cases in our sheriffdom, but we actually have the best capacity in the sheriffdom. Other authorities are really struggling just now, but we're actually saying we're managing, we could probably do a bit more, which is a real positive and a testament to the recent changes that our justice service made to the capacity and how they're structuring things there. It's the same for structural deferred sentences and bail supervision and electronic monitoring. We're really bolstering our services here and really showing that we can support that really well locally. And we're seeing an uplift in the numbers of people that are coming through, which is great. For people who are sentenced, we do a lot of work with them in the community. So that is where you get your typical unpaid work, where somebody maybe is undertaking gardening activity, or they're building planters or going in schools. For a lot of these clients, they're also supervised for a period of up to 2 years a lot of the time. And because they have so much exposure with us, we can really coordinate a structured programme of support around them, where we're pulling in employability, we're pulling in colleagues from housing, from our mental health teams, from our alcohol and drugs teams. So yeah, we get a lot of good outcomes from that. And the last wee bit, helping people who are liberated. So in Renfrewshire, there are around 20 to 25 people that leave custody and come back in every month. But that is a bit of a challenge because sometimes they don't really want to speak to social work at that point. They feel that there's a bit of a power imbalance. And quite often we are relying on other services to break that that kind of door down in the first instance. That's a wee bit trickier when it gets to that stage. The last wee thing to mention here actually is that we need to stop thinking about the justice population as other. A lot of the stigma that we face is because people see the offence as the defining characteristic of that person, and not seeing their life story and not understanding their needs and their hopes, and appreciating that that decision and offending behaviour has been a result of all the things that we spoke about before. What we got recent board approval for was a community justice grant scheme, and this was at the Communities and Housing Board last month. And this was in recognition of the fact that our statutory services are really, really strong, but we're not really going to make the impact that we can until we get our third sector organisations along with us. And we know a lot of them undertake a lot of fantastic work, but we really want to bolster that and support it where we can. So at the moment, we have sent out a wee expression of interest to our third sector organisations, kindly facilitated through Engage. And we've given a population profile. We've shown the types of people that we need our third sector to respond to. And then we're kind of leaving it up to them a wee bit, which is really quite exciting. We're saying, right, so we're telling you that a lot of people who are justice experienced have issues with confidence, that they don't connect very well with our communities, that they quite often cite a lack of leisure and recreation opportunities as being a big, big barrier that they're really struggling forming really, kind of pro-social relationships with folk. And already we're starting to get people coming back and thinking a wee bit differently about you know, I could maybe deliver a service that could help with that. It's maybe not the bread and butter of what I used to do or what we do, but if we tweak this and if we were to get this, then it's something that we can do. And I think really having that mix of statutory and non-statutory support will really help our local offer and only serve to further convince the judiciary and folk that make decisions when they're thinking about, you know, how much success or where is this person going to receive a positive outcome? Is it going to be custody or is it going to be in Renfrewshire's community? Hopefully we can make an overwhelming, you know, kind of plea that our community is the best place to be. So if you have the opportunity to make your local third sector organisations or organisations that operate in your areas aware that this grant scheme is live, that would be smashing. And if we're circulating things off the back of this meeting, I can make sure that I include the link along with the slides. Sorry, my dog. And we can get that circulated to anyone who you think will benefit.
Thanks very much, Jamie. That was absolutely fantastic. I'm a nurse by trade myself, and I work in the community setting. So I must say I resonate strongly with the message that you're wanting to sort of put forward today. I suppose for me, before I bring other people in, I suppose for me it's that link to trauma as well. Like that's obviously a huge focus of services, and actually I've found that there's many community resources that make it a lot easier and takes the weight off of our mainstream services for health, for example, like I said, because that's the work that I do. So I've seen it firsthand what a difference this sort of approach takes to making a difference on people's lives and also where there are victims to these type of, you know, I know it's been generic here. I know that victims and how it affects them and their lives it can differ from one to another. But when they see individuals that are maybe in their communities that have done offending behaviours, are then doing something worthwhile, it makes them feel like they can move forward to some extent. Not in every case, but I know that there are cases where that can be the case. So thank you very much. There are a couple of hands up in the room, so I'm just going to bring them in one at a time. So we've got David, followed by Councillor McLaren, followed by Jacqueline.
Hi, Jamie. Did I pick it up right that you're part of the Chief Executive's Department?
Yes, I am.
Have you been made aware of an issue we're having in Dargavo with effectively problems with youth issues causing quite a bit of upset to, and I believe it's handicapped people in the social housing areas. I have done a bit of investigation, and one of the lead problems is a 7-year-old who could outswear a squad of navvies. Have you been communicated from the chief executive, because we've communicated to him the complaint that we've had? Have you had any knowledge of that?
No, Mr. Woodrow, I haven't. And to be honest, it's not something that would be within the remit of my job. So my role is to look at improvement activity for people who have arrived at court. So the scope of my work is that as soon as somebody arrives at court, right. And then when consideration is given to what route they go down. But I'm sure other people on the call, we can follow that up for sure.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Councillor McLaren.
Thanks, Michelle. Thanks, Jamie. Just wanted to talk to you about the community payback scheme that you mentioned. And I agree with you that providing these ex-criminals with some skills is a good thing. But I'm a bit concerned when I hear that they can't do decorating, for instance, because that might involve climbing a ladder. And so the skills that they're getting must be pretty basic if they're not being trained to climb a ladder. Are you aware of this, and can we do a bit more training than the very basic stuff?
It's something we are looking at, Councillor McLaren, and funnily enough, we recently, through funding that we received through our Alcohol and Drugs Partnership, did a bit of work with our unpaid work clients, and we actually used photographer and a psychotherapist to work with our unpaid work clients for a series of 8 weeks and to create visual representations of what that experience is like. And I got a wee preview today, and one of the pictures was all their tools beside a health and safety notice, and it was just let us go on with it. So our unpaid work clients are identifying this as well. I think obviously we need to create a safe environment. We need to make sure everyone's safe. The actual workshops where our unpaid work clients work, they're like techie labs at school. You know, they've actually got really big bits of equipment down there, a whole raft of tools. It's really quite impressive, and I think for that reason they need to make sure that they're managing the safety of people quite closely. But we are minded that we need to create opportunities for people to develop, and through our local employability partnership we're actually looking at that as well, so that if people are undertaking very maybe basic, or they're getting an introduction to worker skills that they've not had before, actually there are pathways for them off the back of that, so that even when their unpaid work order ends, there's somewhere that they can go. So yeah, we're very mindful of that, and we hope to tease it out in more detail in the coming weeks and months.
Okay, so Jamie, obviously this has been a really good presentation. Once things are at a point for maybe sharing more information with the local partnership about some developments that come with the work that you're doing, I'm sure that's something that'll be well received by this local partnership. So we'll have this sort of come back at some point. I'll bring in Jacqueline at this point. Thank you.
I'm all for the needs not deeds approach, absolutely, but just in terms of the support that they get, just I sit in the children's panel, so we get a lot of reports coming through and a lot of information, and sometimes it's the stats about the reoffending, you know, the percentage, how likely are they, the high, mid, medium, low of reoffending. But one of the things they don't take into consideration is domestic abuse. So in other words, somebody could be at a low risk of reoffending, but they're, you know, a prolific, you know, the domestic abuse for numerous partners. So I guess it's just in terms of all the community work and stuff like that, kind of, is there sufficient help out there for people to be accessing to help them deal with domestic abuse that they're perpetrators of? Because that's a huge concern, that it's not something that's really taking cognizance of, that, you know, these people might be seen as low risk offenders, but in actual fact they're significantly high to their partners, and they might be in prison saying I'm a single person, but only because they know they've had to say that to go in to say, no, they're safe, we're no longer together. So that's just one area that I think is that you know, if you're looking to get grants, it might be bodies that could work with these people to particularly work with domestic abuse.
I think that's a really good point, and there's a nervousness around that cohort of people, and I think that's quite understandable. For people that present that level of risk, a lot of their intervention will be delivered by social work, so that will form part of the decision making, whether it be by the fiscal or whether it be by the sheriff. If it's in the case of the sheriff will be very mindful and very aware of the specific justice staff-led programmes that we have in Renfrewshire that are very, very prescriptive. You know, they're very rooted in practice, and they have very formal outputs and outcomes. But the community-based support around that, I think, is important as well. And just as a wee example, through work with our local employability partnership, we have specialist employability provision for people who have sexual convictions, because we recognise that that is a group that is very, very other. You know, a lot of people, one, I think, get really intimidated and mixed up by what a sexual conviction is, and how that impacts upon disclosure and whatnot. But also because it's a growing population, because there are more and more things that are now falling under that category that weren't before. So that's an example of how we're trying to commission and how we're trying to bolster that statutory element of it. And if community organisations were willing to do that and they felt comfortable to do it, then that would be great. But they would I suppose, been no expectation that we would direct people with those sorts of convictions to organisations that might not be equipped or ready to deal with them as well. So it would be very much on a case-by-case basis.
Okay. I'm going to bring in Councillor Early Nicholson, then I've got something that I just want to have as a contribution as well.
Thanks very much, Chair. Thanks very much, Jamie. A really good presentation and actually really good to see how well you're managing the people that are coming to you through the court process. I'm a strong believer in community in terms of recidivism, and your figures show that out with, you know, that the more people that we get away from custodial sentences, the less likely they are to continue that pattern of behaviour for the rest of their lives. For some people, there will always be a small number of people that are in that situation, but actually the background of people, I think, is, you're absolutely correct, is really, really important. You know, we work in communities here where we have a lot of difficulties and trauma and a lot of families and a lot of children who experience really horrific background, yet we expect them to come out and be model citizens without any help from anybody at all. And if we've got a system of justice at all that can look at a person's background and say that was a really difficult thing that you've came through, and we can't overlook the fact that you've caused harm to other people, because I think that's important that we do that as well, but actually we need to be looking at how do we prevent that from happening in the future. How do we give them belief that they can be an asset to a community, not something that needs stigmatised or causes us real difficulty. So I like the direction of the service. I like the presentation that you've done and the focus that you're putting around that. Pleased to see that there's risk assessment, because communities do need to be aware around about people who have been convicted. Just to mean, I work in social care. Social worker who graduated in terms of criminal justice. So I'm clearly a person who thinks actually people are assets to start with, and we don't all start out to be bad. And actually life can get in the way for some people, but also to remind people, these people who we are supporting through this service are part of our community. They're our relatives, they're our neighbours, so they're not other people as such, they're part of our community. And so thanks for that.
Thanks, Councillor, I appreciate that.
Yeah, and I suppose piggybacking off the back of what Councillor Early Nicholson's saying and what Jacqueline's saying, I suppose it's a query in my head, just because, and I understand that you addressed off the point around domestic abuse and individuals that in particular are involved in the court systems and the social work bit. But then there's also, I feel, there's this gap where we have, in particular, young men who may be exposed to that type of environment as a victim, but without realising it. And they maybe do sort of fall into the category that they might fall into services where yourselves, like they do a crime that's a more petty crime, but there needs to be sort of a community justice approach taken, it's identified. But, you know, although they've not maybe done something that is an offensive behaviour at that point around domestic abuse, the fact that they've been exposed to those environments for often, it can be for a lot of their young years. And I think that's, how do you build that narrative that not all people and young, in particular, and I know I'm very being gender specific because it's gender heavy that way, that not all men are bad men, and just because that's your experience, that doesn't mean you have to act in the same way. You know, how do we best support young men that maybe, like I said, I'm not expecting you to cover off the whole subject matter, but for those that maybe where there's an opportunity for you to engage with those individuals, you know, how would you, is there sort of a specific approach you would take, or is that something more that you would sort of take to other services, their sector, or is that work that sort of happens?
I think that ties in really nicely to what we're hoping to do with this grant scheme, because whether or not somebody has committed an offence like that, or, you know, if that's the reason why they arrive at social work will have these conversations with them. The assessment that social work staff will undertake is very comprehensive, and it will look at a whole raft of situations and experiences and attitudes and behaviours that all culminate in their behaviour and why they are in the position that they're in. And you're right that their offence or their behaviour might not hit a threshold, which means that we qualify for intervention, for example, in the statutory supports that I spoke about in relation to domestic abuse or that sort of offending. But where we can model behaviour positively, that's where we're going to get the real benefit from. So where we might have social work doing something quite specific, or maybe supporting conversations around mental health or alcohol and drugs, or sort of criminal attitudes, where we can then get that person participating in something that's community-based, where their aspirations become the person that they're working alongside with. It becomes that peer. It's all right, so that's normal. That's what I should be aspiring to. I can see how that person is actually integrated in the community and they seem happy and this is what they've achieved with their lives. So that's where this grant scheme is really, I think, going to bear fruit by giving us the access to pro-social role models, essentially.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Alan McNiven.
Thanks, Councillor. It was really just to offer a bit of praise on both the approach and in terms of Jamie as well. Jamie's made himself really available to the wider third sector network, including the Wellbeing Network and a range of other platforms to get this message across. I suppose I wanted to come in to give that really positive feedback about Jamie's approach and the potential of the grant fund. But it's to note that a lot of third sector organisations do have are concerned about maybe coming into this kind of role. So the kind of, we are at the start of something and we need to be really positive about it. And I think Jamie is presenting some really positive information there that's really useful to the members of the third sector. But you can understand sometimes how organisations don't know if they're capable of supporting people coming out of the criminal justice system. So this kind of approach where it's more Jamie saying, well, what could you do, and giving the organisations that chance to maybe look at their operation and come up with some ideas that are valuable to the individuals, but also valuable to the local community, I think is excellent. So it was just to say that, just to note that as a really bit of positive work. Thanks, Chair.
Well, thanks very much, Alan. Jamie, that has been really well received. So thank you, not just for the presentation, but for the clear passion that you have for this area of work. It shines through. So you just know that if there's any progress points and you want to come back to this local partnership, you're absolutely welcome to come back. And likewise, if you're looking for feedback from ourselves as well, we're more than happy to do so. Okay, so you go and enjoy the rest of your evening. We shouldn't be too much longer behind you, unless there's any other members or any other questions for Jamie. No, okay, thank you very much, Jamie.
Excellent. Thanks, everyone. Appreciate that. Bye-bye.
Thank you. So moving on to the last item of the evening is the timetable for meetings for Erskine and Shin and Bishopton Land Bank Local Partnership. Can we agree the dates that are mentioned in the report?
Agreed.
The item is agreed. Thank you very much. Can I thank everyone for your attendance this evening and for your participation in these items, and I hope you have a good evening.
Thank you.
To
thanks, Chair.
Thanks, Chair.
Cheers. Bye.
Thank you.